Indian Renaissance, right? What is this Indian Renaissance? What is the contribution of the Indian Renaissance? This is one topic. See, Indian Renaissance refers to the socio-religious reform movements of the 19th century. Indian Renaissance refers to the socio-religious reform movement of the 19th century. Sometimes we used to say, some of the people used to say that in India, there has been no Renaissance. What is the meaning of Renaissance? In the world history, you would have known the word Renaissance. Renaissance means rebirth, new birth. New birth of what? Human being? New birth of an idea, new birth of a concept, new birth of a new orientation, new thinking is called Renaissance. What is this Renaissance? Renaissance means rebirth. Rebirth of what? Ideas, concepts, orientation, new thinking, new way of life. If this happens in a particular period, we call this period as the Renaissance period. In Europe, this happened around the 15th, 16th, 17th century. The Renaissance were responsible for the modernization of Europe, the scientific aspect of Europe, industrialization of Europe, and the negative aspect of the Renaissance is colonialization of other countries from the European powers. That also is a result of Renaissance only in the European context, I am telling. Right? So some of the historians compare the European Renaissance period and compare the Indian Renaissance and say that in India there has been no Renaissance which had happened. Around the 1700s, around 1600s, there was no Renaissance in India. We don't have any thinkers. Like in the West, we have Adam Smith, we have Washington, then we have different Rousseau, Montesquieu, Voltaire, right? We have many, many scholars who are responsible for giving new thinking, new orientation. Such type of things were not present in India. So the India, some of the historians try to portray India, paint India as a period of absence of Renaissance or the period of dark age in history. Around 1600, 1700, 1800 so. But we will not accept this argument if you see. We will not accept this argument because in 1900s, say 19th century means 1800s to 1900s, 19th century means 1801 to 1900, 19th century. In 19th century in India, if you see, this period is characterized by the rich flowering of so many movements. These movements we refer as socio-religious reform movements. Socio-religious reform movements. Socio-religious reform movements. This period we call in history as the period of Indian Renaissance. Why, sir? The socio-religious reform movements gave a new orientation, gave a new thought, a new idea to the Indian society. See, we will not take each and every socio-religious reform movement. I am calling this as religious reform, socio-religious reform, because the reformation happened in religion, the reformation happened in the society as well. So that is why I am calling it as a socio-religious reform. Reformation was in society, reformation was in religion, combined the reformation took place. So we are calling it as a socio-religious reform in the 19th century. My point is that I am not going to speak about all the socio-religious reform movements. But if you take all the socio-religious reform movements in one jar, in one mixie, if you put all the socio-religious reform movement, run the mixie, take the juice, filter the juice, what is existing, that existence led to the development of new thinking, new idea, new way of life. That content. So, the contribution of socio-religious reform movement is that juice. Contribution of the socio-religious reform movement is the juice. Sir, what is that juice? That you have to know. What is that juice? You have to know. So, the socio-religious reform movement, if you put all the socio-religious reform movement, and what is the contribution? The socio-religious reform movement, first, it were responsible for elimination of all social superstitious practices. All superstitious practices which is prevalent in the society. Superstitious practices. For example, the superstitious practices like crossing a cat, in reptile, falling on your head, Right? There are so many superstitious practices in India which existed. So the reform movements cleared the road. It cleared the superstitious practices away from the thinking and thought process of man. It said that it is not having any relevance. The socio-religious reform movements did one more thing. It gave a clarity on the religious aspect of life. It gave a clarity. Because religion which emerged, whether it is in Hindu religion, whether it is other religion, the existence of different religious practices in India is a remnant or the offshoot of the major religion which is called a Brahmanical religion or the Vedic religion. Vedic religion, later Brahmanical religion. All the religious trends in India were an offshoot or a jumping aspect or something which emerged from the main branch or the main root of the Hinduism as a religion. If you see, over a period of time, there were an accumulation of so many practices in these religion, whether it is in Hindu religion or the offshoots of different religious practices. There is an accumulation of certain things which we call it as taboo, which we call it as taboo, which I call it as superstition. So the socio-religious reform movement gave a clarity on these religious practices. It told what is the religious practices 2000 years back. What is existing today? Why there is so much deviation? 2000 years back, it was pure. That's why Dhananda Saraswati said, go back to the Vedas. Dhananda Saraswati said, go back to the Vedas. Dhananda Saraswati said, you have to go to the Vedic age, Vedic period. Why? Because there it was pure. Today, in the 1900s, it is impure. The gap of 2000 years, 2500 years were responsible for the accumulation of dirt. So the socio-religious reform movement were responsible for clarification of the dirt, clearing the dirt which were accumulated in every religious offshoot which were prevalent in 19th century. You understand what I'm speaking? Which were prevalent in the 19th century. So it gave a clarity. So the socio-religious reform movement made the educated Indians to see the religion in a scientific manner, to investigate the religion in a scientific manner. Example, Rajaram Mohan Roy was a rational man, a man of reason, a Western educated scholar, you must know. But he never abandoned the Indian religion and followed Christianity. He never abandoned. His knowledge in the Western science and the Western philosophy acted as an instrument to investigate the Indian religion which he followed. So he cleared the path, he highlighted the things which are true, the things which have been accumulated as a dust. So that clarity is a result of the socio-religious reform movement. Another example I can take is Swami Vivekananda. Swami Vivekananda is the man who equally criticized and condemned the Indian religion. When he condemned the Indian religion, Hindu religion, he did not condemn the religion per se. He condemned the superstitious practices which had been accumulated in the Indian religious system. Superstitious practices which had accumulated in the Indian religious practices. Right? So the socio-religious reform movements were responsible for giving a clarity in religion. Number third, the socio-religious reform movement also were responsible for empowerment of women, empowerment of downtrodden. Every religious movement, it gave an importance to women, significance of women, importance of women, whether it is a widow, whether it is education of a widow, whether it is any evil associated with the women, the socio-religious reform movement took great care to address this issue of women. Right? So the socio-religious reform movement were responsible for the empowerment of women, abolition of sati, means widow remarriage legislation in 1856, abolition of sati in 1829. All this is the result of what I'm saying now. And not only that, others downtrodden. When I use the word downtrodden, I'm speaking about the so-called untouchables in the Indian society. Every socio-religious reform movement said that the untouchables should be treated equal. The religious reformers, they said so. Though in the society it was not so much accepted, certain things were done actually to break the barrier between the upper and lower. For example, arrangement of common food. Festivals where common food could be served. Upper class, middle class, lower class, caste. Upper caste, middle caste, lower caste, all would come together, they will eat the food. So like these ceremonies were arranged by the educated Indians, the social reformers. So the so-called untouchables, they were to some extent, not fully, to some extent were identified and tried to be uplifted. Right? So this is another contribution of the social religious reform movement. The fourth contribution of the social religious reform movement is the spread of education, awareness, spread of education and awareness. Irrespective of any social religious reform movement, they all contributed in the development of education, you must know. Education. Whether it is an Western education, whether it is an Indian education, whether the education is for the revival purpose or it is for the reform purpose. Western education, reformed. Ancient education, Indian education, revival purpose. So, example, Arya Samaj, if you see, Arya Samaj, it started Dayananda Anglo-Vedic schools. Dayananda Anglo-Vedic schools. Then it started Gurukul Pathsala. Again, Islam, Aligarh movement, if you see, Muslims, he also started an university, Aligarh school, Mohammedan Anglo-Oriental school. So the contribution of education, the social religious reform movement contributed greatly for the development of education. So women, education, clarity on the religion, these points I had said. And sir, the socio religious reform movement were responsible, you must know, for many other aspects. Spread of unity, brotherhood. The socio religious reform movement tried to amalgamate Hindus and Muslims, Christians, Parsis, Sikhs in all one group. Amalgamation, the concept of brotherhood was a result of the social religious reform movement. None of the social reform movement gave an idea of hatred towards other. They never said you have to hate the other. They never said you have to dislike the other. Right? The social religious reform movement said, yeah, you are all our brothers. Brotherhood, the concept of brotherhood is also preached by the social religious reform movement. Right? The social religious reform movement gave so many contributions, if you write, so many contributions. One by one, all these contributions you could write in this answer, in this aspect. Right? So the social religious reform movement was a real renaissance, new birth, new idea, if you see. The most important contribution which I would see by the social religious reform movement is the aspect of what is called as humanism. Aspect of something which is called humanism. Humanism means human as a center of discussion, human as a center of theme of religion. The other normal religion puts God in the center of, God as the center of discussion. Religion is putting God as the center of discussion. But the socio-religious reform movement introduced the concept of humanism where man is the center of discussion. For example, instead of giving undue importance to what is called as God, God and God, the socio-religious reform movement said man is important, welfare of man, empowerment of man, removal of poverty of man. All this is done by the socio-religious reform movement. Mainly Vivekananda, if you see. Vivekananda said what? Service to man is service to God. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa also said, serve man, service to man is service to God. Are we understanding this? So the point here is that the socio religious reform movement were responsible for introducing this concept of humanism for the first time in the 19th. That is why the socio religious reform movement were associated with solving of all the evils, solving of clearing of all the problems. Sometimes social religious reform movement is also responsible for introducing certain fundamental hygienics, if you see. Cleanliness is godliness. Cleanliness is godliness. So we have to keep the houses clean. So the social religious reform movement, it reformed religion, it reformed society, and it were responsible for creation of an harmonious brotherhood based society in India in the 19th century. And the other important point, we can go on reading many points, but the other important point is that the social religious reform movement provided the foundation for building up of nationalism. Provided foundation for building up of nationalism. Nationalism is the building, social religious reformation is the foundation. Without social religious reformation, the concept of nationalism could not have been built in India. So the precedence of social religious reform movement is a necessity for the sequentiation of the nationalism in the latter period. So the social religious reform movement gave a base. So many contributions you can write. So this is about the socio-religious reformations of the 19th century or the Indian Renaissance during the 19th century.